So, welcome once again. In today's talk, I am going to be talking about cryptographic hash function. So, our agenda is not actually to tell about a specific cryptographic hash function. So, in today's talk, we will be mostly concentrating on hash functions and its utilities and why we need cryptographic hash functions. Mostly on that. So, our agenda is something like we will try to understand first of all what is a hash and why hash functions are needed. That is mostly in general term. So, in general sense there is nothing cryptographic stuff there, and then we will gradually try to understand what is the meaning of a cryptographic hash, and then some more things like one wayness and collisions and some of the beautiful applications of cryptographic hash function. Now, in general, what is a hash function? Forget about all cryptographic stuffs. What is a hash function? A hash function is any function that can be used to map data of arbitrary size to a fixed size values. This is important. So, it is a function which maps arbitrary size text file or arbitrary size data to a fixed size data. Examples. So, take this example. So, in this example we have taken some arbitrary names. It may be arbitrary size. So, I really do not know how long this name is. So, it is arbitrary name and it is mapped to a fixed size data. So, fixed size data means it is only 2-digit number. So, arbitrary size name or arbitrary name will map to 2-digit numbers. Now, here in the context of hash functions, before going to go into the further detail, we need to know two important concepts. One is called the domain, another is called the range. So, domain is all possible raw inputs. For example, in this case, in this example of names, all possible names, that is the domain. And all 2-digit numbers, that is from 00 to 99, that is the range. Or you may say set up all possible integers, positive integers. So, that is from 0 to infinite, all possible integers will map to say for example 4-digit numbers. So, 0000 to 9999, that means all of these numbers, that is called the domain, and the numbers on which it will map is called the range. So, immediately from this two questions come into our mind. So, recall once again that this Bob Smith is mapped to 23, this Charles Moore is mapped to 15, Anna Lee is mapped to 57, Ileana Lopez to 11, Carolina Miller to 29. So, immediately what comes in our mind is how we have selected those integers. So, I mean how this 57 I have achieved from this Anna Lee, or how this 29 I have achieved from Carolina Miller. Are they arbitrary? The answer to this question is definitely no, they are not arbitrary. So, how we have calculated that? We have applied some logic on this name which is the input, and we have got these numbers, and that logic is called the hash function. So, hash function is a function or some sort of logic or some sort of mathematical computations by which from the domain or from the input we come up to a smaller fixed valued output. So, you can take a visualization of that. So, that is our input, it may be arbitrarily large, a very large text file, it may be very small text file, it may be the entire movie MP4 file, or it may be your entire hard disk. So, that is a text file, or that is a binary file, you can say. So, your movie file, your text file or whatever it is. So, that is the arbitrary text. Now, this hash function's task is to convert that into some fixed value. Fixed value means the value with say for example 100 bits. So always it will take 100 or 1000 bits, whatever it is. The important thing is to note that it is not random, means that if I start with the same input, I will always get the same output. That is why it is called a deterministic value. For example, if we apply some sort of logic as the hash function, so this Annalee will always map to 57, or Carolina Miller will map to 29. It's not like that today if I apply this Carolina Miller to this hash function, it will become 29, and in the very next day if I apply this Carolina Miller to this hash function, it's going to give me other than 29. So that is not going to happen here. So the important thing is to remember is that it is a deterministic one. So the same input, so input is fixed. If it is x input, so if I apply hash on that, if it gives me y, then always whenever I will take x, it's going to give me y. So that is one important thing that you have to remember. So once again, you have to recall that it need not be integer. For example, in this case we have taken integer, so Annalee has been mapped to integer, Carolina Miller has been mapped to 29, but it's not, it need not be integer. It can be any other type of values, maybe characters, maybe binary numbers, but in most of the cases integers and binary numbers are more convenient than others. So take an example. So I can have a kind of hashing which is something like this, that Bob Smith will be hashed to BM, Charles Moore will be hashed to CM, Anna Lee will be hashed to AL. You are getting the logic essentially, that it's I am taking the hash logic is essentially I am going to take the initials of the first name and the surname, and definitely we are going to get a, so this is actually a hash function. Why? Because no matter what the name is, I will always get a value which is a 2-character value. On the other hand, I can take certain integers also. Say for example, in case of Bob Smith, how these numbers are coming, it may be because I would like to take the position of these letters. So B is the second letter of the English alphabet, O is some letter in this English alphabet, then again B which is the second letter in this alphabet, so I will add them up all, and then if it exceeds 100, then I will take the modulo operation on this 100, on this number. So ultimately I am going to get something like this, 23. I really do not know whether exactly it is going to be 23 or not, but it is going to give me some numbers from 00 to 99. So that is what is the intention, because I am taking the modulus operation at the very end. So this number will map to some 2-digit number, this number will map to some 2-digit other number, this number will map to 2-digit some other number, in that way it is going to work. So that is the way we apply the hash function, or that is the basics of hash function. So we may have characters, we may have numbers, numbers are more convenient, but it is not that characters are useless, we can use also that. So the first lesson that we would like to learn is that if you know the hash function, what is the logic, and if you know the text, then you can get the output. So it is text plus hash function is equal to the output. So if you know the hash function, what is the logic that I am applying, if you know that, if you know the text, then you can get the output. For that text, applying that hash function, you are going to get that output. So this is our lesson number one, keep it in your mind. So this is our lesson number one. So if I know text and the hash, I can compute the hash function's output. The second question that will come into your mind immediately, that well, it is fine, but how to get the numbers from the text? That is was our the first question. The second question is, okay, what will happen, or is it possible that more than one name will map to the same initials or same hash functions? For example, take a closer look to this one. Charles Moore, his hash value is CM, and Carolina Miller, her has value is also same. So, what will happen that both of them, this guy and this person, they are hashed to the same value. The answer to the second question is yes, always this is going to happen. Why? Because there are many possibilities in name and the output is only a fixed finite size. For example, in this case we have only 26 × 26, which is equal to 676 possible output values. 26 means the first character may be one of the A through Z and the second character will be one of the A through Z. So, all together there are 23 alphabets. So, 26 alphabets. So, 26 × 26 is going to give you total 676 possible outputs, but the possible inputs can be millions. So, there may be millions such different names. So, from where we are going to map to only 676 output values. So, collisions or such type of value which will go to the same hashed output is obvious, you cannot really get rid of it. So, our second lesson is also important, that a hash function maps a larger set into a smaller set. That means collision is obvious, you can check this thing. So, suppose there are 6 different balls and 4 different containers. So, if you would like to accommodate all of the balls in those 4 containers, so definitely there will be at least 1 or 2 containers which will having more than one ball. Something which is called a pigeon hole principle. So, if you have more pigeons than the pigeon hole, then definitely some hole is going to take more than one pigeon. So, that is obvious in this case. So, your domain is large, your domain contains many names, but your range contains only 5 or 676 or so possibilities. So, definitely more than one names are going to map to the same output or same hash value. Now, let us try to ask a different question. So, can you do the reverse thing? What does that mean? It means, can we find the name from the hashed output value? Or in a visualized way, it is something like, you know the hash function, you know the output, which is the HX output value. Can you conclude what is the value of this original X? So, this question is not that very obvious, it has certain other deeper understanding. So, let us discuss it. There are 3 different folds to this question. The first fold is pre-image. Pre-image means, suppose this is X and this is HX, which I will call as Y. So, this X generates this Y. So, if I know this Y, obviously I know this hash function also. So, using this hash function and this Y, can we get back to this X? If I can get back, then I will call that I can obtain the pre-image. So, this is essentially called pre-image, this is called post-image. So, from the output getting back to the input is called reconstructing the pre-image from the post-image. Yeah. So, for example, in our name example, we have given AL, which is the abbreviation of someone's name. So, can you construct the original name? For example, can you construct Anna Lee from there? If you can, then you can construct the pre-image. If you cannot, then you can say it is a pre-image resistant hash function, or this method is called pre-image resistance, that you cannot really construct the original name. And if you think that, okay, many inputs are coming to one hashed output, so probability is impossible. So, let me tell you that it is not always. If your hash design is bad, then at certain point of time you can exactly compute what is the pre-images. So, in that case you have to remember that it not only depends that many inputs are coming down to a single output, but it may so happen that because of your bad design, you will be able to reconstruct the pre-image. So, let us take an example. Suppose our domain is the set of all positive integers. That means we are taking from 1 through infinite all of the positive integers, that is our domain set. Our hash function is something like this. So, this is our hash function, and our range is from 0 to 99. Now, let us take a closer look to the hash function. So, what is the hash function? Hash function is x, whatever x I will supply. So, x plus 50 if x is less than 50, and x percentage 50 if x is greater than 50. So, let us check what will happen there. Suppose x is equal to anything between 0 through 49. So, if x is equal to, say for example, 33, as it is less than 50, so the hash output will be, which is equal to 83. And whenever I will cross this 50 barrier somewhat over here, then what am I going to do? I am going to take the modulo 50 operation. So, modulo 50 operation means my output will be bounded between 0 through 49. So, the numbers will be something like this. From 0 to 49, all of the numbers will map to actually 50 through 99. And rest all other numbers 50 to infinite, all of them will map to something from 0 to 49. So, this 0 to 49, here all of the numbers from 50 to infinite, they will map, and from number 0 to 49, they will map to 50 to 99. Just take a closer look. Better you take a pause here in my video and just think. The thing will be clear to you. So, now it is very clear. So, if you know that it is 83, then you know that it is exactly the pre-image is 33. There is only one image that is there. So, only 33 can generate 83. No other value can generate. But it is, you can reconstruct exactly the pre-image from where it is coming. So, it is a very bad design of bad hash function, but still my intention is to show you that it does not make any sense that all of the inputs are come or there are more number of elements in the domain set than the number in the range set. Means I cannot deterministically say which one is the pre-image. I can if my hash function is not well designed. Okay. So, this is one thing that is called pre-image computation. So, if I can compute the pre-image, then it is not pre-image resistant. If I cannot compute the pre-image, then it is pre-image resistance. Then come to another important concept, which is called second pre-image resistance, second pre-image and the second pre-image resistance. So, what is second pre-image? Second pre-image is, suppose somebody has stated, okay, I have something, some plain text, and its hash output is L. You don't need to know which one is my text. You come up with another text whose output is also AL. So, you can recall that in our original name example, AL was coming from Anna Lee, but now if somebody comes with Alexa Lawson, her name is also going to go to AL. So, I really do not know what you have opted. But I have also opted another thing which is coming down to the same hash value, that is called a second pre-image. So, I am not sure what is your text, but my text is also giving the valid output that you are giving. So, in this image it is clear. So, your text is x, I may come up with another value which is equal to y, and both of them are going to map to the same hash value, which is AL in this case. So, then this sort of things are called second pre-image, and if your hash function cannot generate a image something like this y, then it is called second pre-image resistance. And if you think that, okay, in this case it is very easy, I can come up with any other name where I can generate AL or any other type of thing, it is not always. Let us take another example, then the thing will be clear to you. Suppose your hash function is something like this. I will hash some integers, typically positive integers, from 0 through infinite down to some numbers from 0 to 99. So, 2-digit numbers, so 00 to 99. And my hash function is a bit complicated one. So, what is that? Say, for example, my number x that I am going to hash, which is in this domain. So, this domain I have opted one number which is equal to 321, for example. Then it has 3 digits. So, digits are, this is d1, this is d2, this digit is d3, and my hash function is 321 to the power 15 plus 321 to the power 8, 321 to the power 8 plus 321 to the power 3 plus 1, all these stuffs into 3 to the power 5, because d1 to the power 5, 3 to the power 5 plus 2 to the power 5. 2 to the power 7, sorry, 2 to the power 7, because there is 7, then 1 to the power 9, and then all this large value, I am going to take a percentage or modulo operation with the 100. So, ultimately this thing will come back to some number between 00 to 99. So, now in this case, if I come up with some output which is equal to, say, for example, 33, it will be more difficult for you to compute another value other than what I have opted to come to this 33. It is more difficult, but obviously you can get, because there are only 100 possibilities. So, if you try randomly at one point of time, you will get another value or some value whose hash value is equal to 33, because you have only 100 different possibilities. But in case of our name, you can, in a single second, you can come up with a different name whose outcome or the hash value which is equal to AL. But in this case, it is not so obvious. So, you need more computations. So, that is what is our intention, that it is not impossible, but if you think from cryptography's point of view, so having a second pre-image needs more sort of computations. So, now you are getting an idea. So, in case of cryptography or cryptographic hash, we will design a hash function in such a way that it needs huge amount of computations. I am not saying that it is impossible, but it demands huge amount of, or technically infeasible amount of computations. And the third concept is simple collision. What is the collision? Take a closer look to this picture and then come down to this question. This question is a bit different. So, earlier question was, my output is AL. Now, come with another text whose output is AL. Now, here I am asking that I am not fixing anything here in the outputs, but I am just telling you, just bring me two texts whose outputs are same. That is my question now. So, there is nothing special about AL. So, I am not saying that you have to come up with a text with AL. You have to come up with two texts. One is x1, another is x2. Both of them will come down to some y. I really do not know which way. So, but they should come down to the same hash value. So, this is a bit easier problem. Right? Because I am not actually fixing up the output value, and I am not forcing you to check which one is the value whose outcome is or hash value is equal to AL. I am just telling you, I am just giving you more liberty that, okay, bring me two texts, x1 and x2, so that they will come down to the single hash value. So, that is called essentially a collision. And from hardness's point of view, collision is much, I mean, it is easier to compute. Second pre-image is more harder than collision computation, and pre-image computation is the hardest among all these things. Okay. So, you have to keep it in mind, if this is case, then if we concentrate on collision, and if we say that some cryptographic hash function where collision computation is very hard, then this one and this one will be even harder or hardest. Okay. So, now we just concentrate a little bit on cryptography. So you may be wondering that in case of hash function, why we are talking about the hardness of the reverse computation. This comes from this fact that in cryptography we need a one-wayness. So hash function in that case means if our forward computation is deterministic and easy, but from the output knowing the hash function, I cannot reconstruct the previous image or reconstruct some of the images whose hash outcome is this same outcome, then it is called a one-way function, and we use them in cryptography. So in cryptographic point of view, forward computation is easy and deterministic. Easy means we can easily compute with a very limited resource and very easily with few seconds, and it is deterministic means the same input will map to same output always. And backward computation is very, 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 very hard. So that is the setup of cryptographic hash function. Now, how to design such type of hash functions? Now, we will not see it in this video, but in our next video, we will see SHA-1 or Secure Hash Algorithm 1. So, we can design a hash function by a very complex non-linear design. So that is one way of making this pre-image computation or collision harder, and the second one is by increasing the output length or increasing the size of the range. So recall, in our earlier range it is mostly from 00 to 99, so only 100 possible things were there. So if we instead from 00 to 99, if we increase our range from 0 to this much values, it will be much harder to find out a collision or second pre-image or pre-image. And if we make it even larger, then it will become even harder. And in cryptography, we will, our range is almost like from 0 through 512 or 0 to 160, which is in case of our SHA-1. So 0 to 2 to the power 160, if this is the range, it is going to be cryptographically hard. That means no matter what sort of computations and resources you take, you cannot really find out a pre-image or a second pre-image or some collision. So that is what is called a cryptographic hash function. So if I precisely define what is a cryptographic hash function, it is going to be something like this. Cryptographic hash function, now it is cryptographic, it is not only hash function, it is cryptographic hash function, is a hash function which maps arbitrary length text, that is important. So now it maps arbitrary length text to a fixed size value, typically 160 bit in case of SHA-1, where the forward computation is easy and deterministic, and all kinds of backward computation, all kinds of backward computations are hard. And all kinds of backward computation means any type of collision. So bring me two different texts that maps to the same, that is the easiest of all such backward computations, so that you cannot really compute. Given a text and its output, can you find out another text which maps to the same output, which is called second pre-image? Is hard. And given the hash function and the output, can you find out from where it has come? That is also hard. So all kinds of, that means these three kinds of reverse computations, all are hard, but this forward computation is deterministic and easy. So that is called a cryptographic hash function. And by hard, reverse computation is hard, it means that if you apply all of the computers of this world, you cannot really come up with a pre-image or a collision in the lifetime of the universe, something like this. Okay. So let us take some of the examples of hash functions. So one of the possible example is digital signature. Recall, in our digital signature video, we have stated that a digital signature works for a small text, typically 512 or 1024 bits text. So, if your text is larger than that, then you are not going to put the digital signature for the entire document. So, for a large document we need to sign. So, in that case we have to trim or you have to cut the entire large document into smaller 512 bits pieces, and you have to put our signature in each and every document, something like this. So, if someone wants to send a message which is large enough, so if we need to cut it down into 512, suppose this is 512, suppose it is not actually, but suppose this is 512, 512, 512. So, what will happen? So, somebody will put his or her digital signature here. So, please do not come. So, three piece of paper, and in transit if somebody destroys this one or steals this one, so the receiver will get please attack. So, it is completely the different meaning. So, earlier who was intended to say so please do not attack, and is going to the person, intended person, and that intended person is saying that yes, it is only please attack. So, it is completely the reverse meaning which is coming, and it is coming from the integrity point. So, the message has been tampered in between, and this is obvious because your message is not a single message now. So, it is a piece by piece message, and your digital signature, you cannot make a remedy to that because your digital signature cannot sign a very large document. So, how we are going to solve that? So, that we are going to solve using our cryptographic hash function. Recall, Ron Rivest, who is the pioneer of such type of cryptographic hash design, he used to say that as a message digest. So, suppose you have a long agreement. So, this agreement has, it may be 1000 different pages of PDF file. So, if I apply cryptographic hash, then we can say that this hash output is the representative of this text. Just try to understand this text or this meaning. So, representative of this text means if I say this is the hash output of some text, that means it is this text only and no other text. You can say why? There may be other texts also. Definitely there are other texts around the world, or there may be other text whose hash map is this. But recall, in our cryptographic hash we have stated that it is impossible to come up with another Y whose hash value is this. I really cannot compute another text apart from this one whose hash value is this. So, what does that mean? So, that means whenever I am coming with this one, I can say okay, this is the representative of this text, because it is almost impossible to come up with another text whose hash value is this one. So, this hash value is actually representative. So, what will happen then? So, now this problem is very simple. So, now instead of this original long 100 page PDF text, I have a hash value which is only maybe 512 bit long. So, what will happen? I will put my signature on this hash value, and what am I going to do? I am going to make this original text which is equal to this one, and the signature which is the signature on this hash, signature on this hash, I am going to make them public. So, I am going to send this signature on the hash and the original text to my receiver. So, what will happen? In the receiving end, he or she will get the original text, he or she will compute the hash. Because hash function, if I know the hash function and the text, I can compute the hash output. There is no key associated with it. It is not encrypted with key or something like that. If you know the text, if you know the hash function, then you can compute the hash output. So, he or she having this plain text will compute the hash output. So, he will compute the hash output, and it will verify whether signature is matching with the hash output that has been computed from the text or not. So, instead of signing the original document, I am just taking the hash of the original document and I am sending it to the receiver along with the original 100 page PDF. So, in the receiving end, this person who has received it will apply the same cryptographic hash function on that PDF and will generate the hash value, and will check whether the signature is reconstructing this hash value or not. If it is so, that means this one is the signature on that PDF. And the idea here is, if you change a bit in this text, some bit in this text, so its hash function will be different from this hash function, and finally you are not going to get so your signature will not be able to match with this newly computed hash function in the receiving end. So another important example is a digital envelope. So now recall that a hash function can be used as a digital envelope. Digital envelope means, suppose I have certain confidential document and which is inside an envelope. So I am putting my signature here, okay. This is an envelope, something is there. So suppose the government has made an agreement with a businessman, and suppose it is a top secret, some sort of deal that has been made between the government and the businessman, and what is the deal, nobody knows. But they jointly make a hash function, and that hash function may be made as public. So they may say, okay, we have made certain business dealing, and this is the hash function which I am making public. So what will happen? Other people, they will not be able to reconstruct what the original message is. They will not be able to come up with another text from this hash function. That is also impossible. But later, if really government or this person, businessman needs to open their deal, so they cannot manipulate. So they have to come up with the same text, because in that case you have already made the hash public. So if you come up with a different text by some manipulation, whenever you need to go to the public for saying, okay, we didn't do anything like that, so this is our agreement that we have made, you cannot deny, because whatever text you will supply to the general people, they will simply compute the hash and will check whether this hash is matching with this hash or not. If it does not match, then this government or the businessman, they are lying. So you cannot later, you cannot deny that which one is the original agreement. So that is something which is called digital envelope, which is very, very crucial in some cases at least. And yet another example is password management. So recall that storing password somewhere in the computer is very tough task. I should not say hard, it's a tough one, because storing the raw password somewhere in the computer means there is a chance of revealing the password. So it may be leaked. So what we can do, we can store the hash of the password. So whenever somebody will give his or her password, instead of matching the password, what I will do, so somebody's password is equal to, say for example, P. So what I am going to do, we are going to apply hash on P. So this is, say for example, Y, and that is what we are going to match with this stored value, whether they are equal or not. So that is the way we can manage the password, and in that case password management will be so easy that you can make all these passwords hash value as public. Somewhere you can place it so that people can read it out. Well, there is nothing wrong, because knowing this Y, you cannot know what is the value of the original password P. So constructing P from Y, it is actually impossible. Okay, and even if you supply Y here, it's not going to work, because hash of Y is not equal to Y, it's not identical hash. So hash of Y is going to give you some other thing. So only P can give you Y. Some other things also can give you Y, but in case of cryptographic sense, you cannot really come up with some other text whose hash value is equal to Y. Okay, so in that case your password management will be very, very easy, and you can make your password's hash output as public even, no problem. So the conclusion from these discussions are, a cryptographic hash is a one-way function with the following properties. The properties are, the forward computations are very easy and they are deterministic. The backward computation is hard, computationally hard, or you can say cryptographically hard. And it maps the arbitrary length text to a fixed length text, typically maybe a very large movie file, some movie dot mp4 to a fixed length 160 bit length. So that is called the message digest, or the digest of this movie, or the representative of this movie. And the important thing is that no key is involved. If you know what is the hash function and if you know which movie has been encrypted, you can also generate the same hash output. That is one of the important things. There is no such key which is involved here. The only thing is that having the H function in your hand and the hash output, you cannot go back to the input. So that is the way we design a hash function in cryptographic sense. Okay. So with this, I would like to conclude. Thanks for watching.